Our opening hymn is hymn 287. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God in glory everlasting. Amen.
On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation."
The Lord's and all that
second reading is from Revelations chapter 21. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." Thanks be to God.
Our sequence hymn is hymn 620. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. "For all the saints who from their labors rest" are the opening words of the first hymn we sang this morning, a hymn that is, of course, appropriate for the feast of All Saints. Perhaps you are wondering just who or what a saint is. Well, Saint Bernard of Clairvaux gives us a list of those who are considered saints in one of his sermons for All Saints Day. His list contains a lot of people that we would consider probably saints because we have heard them as labeled as such. He mentions patriarchs and prophets, the apostles, monastics and martyrs. Would be all those people who have gone through the church's rigorous vetting and scrutiny to see if they have earned the right to be beatified and have the word saint before their names. These would be men and women whom the church considers have borne witness to the one hope, the one truth, rooted in the gospel's proclamation of God's victory in Christ Jesus over death. But then, do you have to be beatified to be a saint? Well, maybe not, because each day, or each year on this particular feast day, we remember and honor all those who have entered into God's nearer presence in the past year. We consider them our own list of saints. So then, does it mean you have to be dead to be a saint? Well, I suppose that is how we think of it, but and certainly is part of today's emphasis, but of course I'm sure we all know living people that we might label as saints, people who emulate sincere loving kindness and compassion and holiness, or people who put up with extreme difficulties and obstacles in life, but with grateful hearts and a cheerful nature. So I guess there are saints above and saints below. what we call the Great Communion of Saints. But still, that brings us back to that question of what is a saint? Well, I found a definition that worked for me, and I'll share it with you and see if it works for you. I found it in a little book called Creative Prayer. And I think it very accurately describes, at least what I understand a saint to be. It says that saints imbue a certain large leisure which goes hand in hand with remarkable effectiveness. They are never hurried. They do comparatively few things, and these not necessarily striking or important. And they trouble very little about their influence. Yet they always seem to hit the mark. Their simplest actions have a distinction, an exquisiteness that suggests the artist. The reason? It's not far to seek. Their sainthood lays in their habit of referring the smallest action to God. They live in God. They act from a pure motive of love towards God. They are free from self-regard, as from slavery to the good opinion of others. God sees, and God rewards. What else do they need? They possess God, and possess themselves in God. Hence the inalienable dignity of the meek, quiet figures that seem to produce such marvelous effects with such humble materials. So on this All Saints Day, we do remember our own long line of those faithful ones who have come before us and whom we honor and treasure in our memories. But there must be something more to this day than the mere honoring of the dead. And to me, the overriding question for this day is, how is it that God's glory is found in this procession of saints, this procession that ends in death? I say this because feasts like this day might conjure up for us feelings of loss or sorrow or fear or anxiety or doubt or despair. You know, we don't like to think about death, especially for someone who is dear to us. Well, we don't, for that matter, like to think about it for ourselves. And we know that death is inevitable, but nevertheless, we are still reluctant to let go of life and want to rebel against death and stave it off as long as we possibly can. Let's face it, death stinks, literally and figuratively. So the deep question that overrides these thoughts should be, where can we glimpse God's glory in all of this? And I think some of the answer is to be found in that story of the raising of Lazarus. Unfortunately, the gospel for today actually begins near the end of that story. So I'm going to back up just a little and catch us up from what went on before. Now, the story of the raising of Lazarus is the story of the resurrection of a human being, a person who was known to many people. It is done in the presence of many witnesses. Now, you probably remember the story well. We've heard it many times. Briefly, Lazarus is dying from some illness. Jesus is called to come, but he doesn't come right away, and Lazarus dies. Jesus goes to Bethany 4 days later, which was a significant thing because in rabbinic belief, after 4 days, the body could no longer encase a human spirit. Anyway, Jesus mourns Lazarus' death and tries to comfort his sisters, and then raises Lazarus. These are the the facts of the story, but there's a lot of subtleties within those facts. Its many-faceted character is revealed in the life and death motif present in each dramatic incident of the story. As I said, Lazarus is suffering from a fatal illness, and right away Jesus declares that the purpose of the illness is not to bring about the death of Lazarus, but rather to point to God's glory and the glorification of the Son of God. So Jesus waits until Lazarus is irrefutably dead before taking any action. Action that is meant to show that Jesus is the resurrection and the life, just as he declares. A fact that is very important to all the saints above and below. Eventually, Jesus says straightforwardly to his disciples, Lazarus is dead, but he adds, for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. Believe what? Well, let us soon see. At Bethany, Jesus meets Mary and Martha, Lazarus' sisters. Each of them, at separate times, laments that if Jesus had come earlier, their brother would not have died. Undaunted, Jesus tries to comfort Martha with these words, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha misunderstands what he says. She agrees with the teaching of the Pharisees that she knows that there will be a resurrection and judgment at the end of time. Jesus sees her misunderstanding and sets her right by saying those famous words, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Though he die, yet shall he live." Still, Jesus is not unmoved by the open weeping of the sisters and the mourners who have come with them. He is greatly disturbed, deeply moved. He weeps himself. It clearly shows that we have a God who is embodied in the triune relationship of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but is not unaffected by the suffering and loss in the world. No, God in Christ fully enters into our sufferings and weeps with us. And then the miracle. The stone is removed, not without protest, but with a reminder that what is about to happen is for the glory of God and the glorification of the Son. The command is given, "Come out," and Lazarus comes forth. This particular miracle is the last of the signs that are recorded in John's Gospel, and perhaps the most astounding one. We have to remember, though, that all of these signs are not just supernatural events, but really are revelations that try to point us to something else or someone else. They testify to us that Jesus, as the Son of God, has given life. This event is pointing to Jesus' own final glorification in his death and resurrection. Think about it. Like this particular scene at Bethany, for Jesus there will be a tomb and a stone and weeping women and linen wrappings. And this means that if we only focus on Lazarus being brought back to life, we've really missed the point. This is not about Jesus raising people on the last day. something way beyond that. You note that Jesus doesn't go into the tomb and bring Lazarus out. He stands outside and commands him to come out. He calls him by name, just as the Good Shepherd calls all of us by name. And he gives him life, just as the Good Shepherd gives life to his flock. That's exactly what it is that Jesus has done and will do for all of us. Jesus is the one who has the power to give life, because Jesus is the presence of God's life become flesh for us. Now, of course, the raising of Lazarus does not negate in any way that idea that Martha has put forth, that the dead will be raised on the last day. But even the resurrected Lazarus, and even the resurrected Lazarus probably didn't go on living forever. Once again, though, I cannot emphasize this enough. This story is there to reveal to us that Jesus is the one in whom there is life. Jesus is the one who calls us out of the dark and binding places of death, unwraps our winding sheets, and sets us free. That's very good news. It, of course, does not mean that anything now will stop the march of death in the world, but it does mean that in Jesus' coming death and resurrection, death is finally and ultimately defeated. This is the whole truth of the Lazarus event. Jesus is the place where death ends and everlasting life begins. There's a French monk poet whose name is Abbé Michel Poist, who writes a lot of prayer poems. One of them is called The Funeral. And in it he says, "There are really no dead people, Lord, only the living, here and beyond. Only the living, here and beyond." So because of Jesus, we know that on both sides of the grave there is life, because Jesus has been sent to us and calls us forth to life by name. Jesus is life here and life beyond. That is what the celebration of All Saints is about. It is not just about remembering those ones from long ago or those ones who are still painfully near who have entered into God's nearer presence. It is not even only about the promise of resurrection on the last day. Of course, these are part of the celebration of the feast day, and we do need to celebrate that. But as Brian Peterson, professor of New Testament at the Lutheran Seminary of the South, writes, more centrally, however, this day is about what all God's saints have known and experienced, that here and now there is no death, or grief, or fear so deep and dark that the voice of Jesus cannot reach into it, call us out, and bring life. Amen. Now I invite you to stand and join with me in saying the Nicene Creed.
set free from sin and death, and nourished by the word of truth, we join in prayer for all of God's creation, saying, "Hear us, O God, your mercy is great." We pray for all who long for a word of truth and for the radical grace that flows from the cross. Inspire all bishops, especially Michael, our presiding bishop, Mike, our bishop, and Matthew, our bishop coadjutor elect, and all priests and deacons to freely and boldly proclaim your love for all people with persistence and hope. Hear us, O God. We pray for your creation, for mountains, rivers, streams, cities, homesteads, and neighborhoods. Write in our hearts a new love and care for creation. Give us the will to curb wasteful habits and to hold accountable those who neglect the vulnerable. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who hold public office, especially Joseph, our president, and Jim, our governor. Pour wisdom and understanding upon all who govern so that communities of justice and peace may thrive. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who long for healing in mind, body, or spirit, especially Bobby Schultz, Shirley Milton, Shirley Bailey, Father David Saylor, Stephen Spurlock, Mick Sinclair, Barbara Estep, Aaron Naughton, James Bach, Andy Boyd, Lynette Sickles, Father Brian Shoda, Linda Traeger, Karen Gross, and Pat Garrett. Strengthen hospitals, clinics, counseling centers, nursing homes, and recovery centers to be holy spaces of renewal that all might live the abundant life you intend. Hear us, O God. We pray for this congregation here at St. Matthew's, especially for those who serve on the various committees of the church, for the search committee, for members of the vestry, and for the trustees. We pray that they will listen and be guided by the workings of the Holy Spirit for our good and the good of all the church. We remember especially Deborah and Bob Traeger, for whom the altar flowers are given in thanksgiving for their anniversary. Hear us, O God.
Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands. Through Jesus Christ, our truth and life. Amen. On this All Saints' Day, I offer this prayer. O Almighty God, who has called us to faith in you and has compassed us about with so great a cloud of witnesses, grant that we, encouraged by the good examples of your saints, remembering especially Richard Bailey, Betty June Nelson Burton, Nathaniel Stilwell Chase III, Jean Hitchens, Sarah Sally Thiroff Holmes, Charles Hughes, Laurel Johnson Myers, George P. Schramm, Linda K. Smith, Dr. Edward Voss, Ruth Voss, Francis N. Kenley, Sylvia Sally Peace, Muriel Bruning Shepp, Dorothy Jean Thomas, and Mary Paul Taylor. May preserve and persevere in running the race that is set before us until at length, through your mercy, we with them attain to your eternal joy. Through him who is the author and finisher of our faith, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now we pray all. also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. In your bulletin, which I'm sure you can read for yourself, I will call your attention to the fact that time changes next week. So we set our clocks back an hour, so don't arrive an hour early next week. So get ready for that coming. I still remind you that pledge cards need to come in, and I again urge you to make your pledge this year. You can send your pledge to the office or drop it in the offering plate. It's not too late. We'll still take your pledge whenever you bring it. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For in the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses, that we might rejoice in their fellowship and run with endurance the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the crown of glory that never fades away. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ, his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Matthew and all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn 625. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.